Hi and welcome back to The Shtick. We're here in the studio with Rabbi Chef Dr. David Trakhtman. You're not a doctor, but you're a chef. You found God behind the oven. I love that, David.
Yes.
Welcome to The Shtick.
Still searching.
Still searching. Well, you're a very interesting character. I've been following you since the first time I met you on Facebook. And we've had a few adventures together over the years.
Yeah.
But your main reason for being here today is your connection with the Ukraine.
Yeah.
So you were born in Siberia.
No.
Or in the northern, it's not called Siberia.
At the top of the Ural Mountains.
It's Arctic Circle.
Arctic Circle of Russia, yeah.
That's why you're such a cool guy. And what age did you come to Ukraine?
I was nine. My parents are originally from there, from Zhytomyr. They went back when I was nine.
Mm-hmm. And your memories of the place?
Ukraine? Interesting because, we left, I was 17. So really the formative years when you're nine, as a teen, when your mind forms, you start understanding things, you start understand even politics a little bit. Culture is the time that I spent in Ukraine, not in the Arctic Circle of Russia. I mean, I have memories from both, but my more vivid memories from that part of the world would come from Ukraine, of course, as I was in school, as I finished school in Zhytomyr, in Ukraine.
So how did you become religious? What was the...
When the Soviet Union fell apart in 91, Lubavitcher Rebbe would send his emissaries, shluchim, to that part of the world to organize communities, to build communities, to open schools, to open centers, synagogues. And one of the projects that they had was a Jewish camp. So there was a camp in Bucha, which is about an hour away from Kiev, and we lived in Zhytomyr, which is about 2.5 hours away by car. And they tried to encourage and sort of advertise the old Jewish boys to join the camp. My friends told me, you should come, it's interesting. Americans boys are coming, if you want to practice your English, which I always had a passion for, that's for you to, you know, nothing necessarily Jewish, because what did I know about Jewish? But to practice English with the American boys, to get to know them, you know, a Jewish camp. But so that's basically, that's how it started. Mm. August 91, the months of the famous coup in Moscow, when the whole thing started to crumble, and officially was dissolved in December, in December 91, started in August.
And then how did you become a rabbi? What was the process?
So I went to Chabad camp, I came back from the camp, I had a breeze in the camp, I came back, and I was already connected with the community, already was a little bit interested and enticed of learning about Judaism, my culture and history. So I would go to the center, Jewish center, or the synagogue that was opened by Rabbi Muli Plotkin, who is Sarah Rabin's grandfather.
Yes.
He was the age of 64. He left his safe home and business in New York and went to Ukraine. And I was one of those young boys that was involved, you know, was spent about a year as I was finished school, and we're already applied to go to Australia as we were waiting for the papers. I said, you know what, I'm going to go to yeshiva in Moscow. So I went to Chabad yeshiva in Moscow. Rabbi Berel Lazar, who is the chief rabbi of Russia now, you know, he was our teacher among others. Wow. I spent a year there in 92 and we came here in 93.
Fantastic. More to the point, besides all the atrocities and the war and whatever we see on because I've been up to 3 or 4 every morning.
Yeah.
Watching the war on television. This is the first war I think we've ever seen that's been so graphic.
Yeah.
You know, it's getting more graphic by the day because you know how tragic it is and what's going on, and nobody knows what tomorrow's going to bring.
Yeah.
I mean, everyone's talking about negotiations and all sorts of things that maybe might happen. We're praying that it will stop because it can't continue. But what I wanted to talk to you about was your attempt now with our community to facilitate Ukrainians coming to Australia who want to come here. What is the process that you've started?
Yeah. So we got together with a friend of mine, Sarah Bendetsky from Super Kitchen, mm-hmm. And just and also David Southwick is helping us a little bit as well. You know, as we're coming out of the shock of the situation, and you know, we are in this crisis, and we coming out of the shock. We're trying to be strong ourselves. We all affected by the crisis. We all have maybe relatives or friends and our memories, recollections from that part of the world. And there's a fairly substantial Jewish and not necessarily Jewish community of immigrants from Ukraine. And we're pulling the strings together. And we're knocking on the big doors of the government like they did for us before we came. Mm-hmm. I believe Izzy Liebler, when he was working very hard for the Soviets to let my people go, and his efforts didn't go in vain, like they did in America when they tried to save Jewish people from the Holocaust. And we're just doing what you know, what anyone would do. What would, I guess we'll take an example from, and try to save them, bring them here, and pulling the strings, consolidating our resources, talents, passions. And experiences to help the Jews and not necessarily Jews to come to Australia. We need people, besides the point. Our country can benefit from these people. They are intelligent people. They are white Caucasians, whether Jewish or Christians. They can be easily integrated into Australian society. These are people with experience in farming, in orchards, in harvesting. Hospitality. We need these people more than you know, than anyone in that sense. And I'm not saying that this is our prime reason and motivation. At the end of the day, we are there to save them. But the truth is, it's sort of as like a killing two rabbits at once in a way. And we are capable to do that. So it's an incredible investment into human resources. And I myself, even I look at myself, when I came here, I became a chef. I was able to follow my passion. And now I'm capable to give back to my community, to my country, Australia, that I love so much. And of course, I think about the Ukrainian Jews and non-Jews, and I'm in touch with my classmates. I haven't been for a while, but I am. I didn't really have any Jewish classmates, but I talk to them, and I'm trying to help money-wise and also say if they're willing to come to Australia, we are capable to help out. We also reaching out to a secular Ukrainian associations, as well as Eastern Orthodox, Ukrainian Eastern Orthodox Church. At this time, we are looking beyond differences and discrepancies. Yep. At this time, it's really helping all the people, pretty much. That's what we're trying to do, yeah.
Wonderful. Is there any way that our viewers can get in touch with you? Is there a particular...
They can. I hope, Henry, you will perhaps advertise on a link.
Yep, I will.
My email address and even my number. I mean, I am a busy man as well, but the thing is, I put a large proportion of my time now into this project. There are stages and logistics. There are stages of bringing them in, filling up forms, immigration department.
Yeah, especially visas.
Visas.
$145 it costs for one visa.
Yeah, I think it's the least of the issues, the $145. Yeah. I mean, it is. We are fundraising.
And accommodation.
Accommodation, schooling, psychological support, housing. Yeah. There's a number of things that we... It's a major, major thing. And that's what we're doing at this stage, is trying to consolidate and create an infrastructure of support. Of support of bringing them in and ultimate integration into community. I am an immigrant myself. I came here when I was 17. I know what's it like to come to a different country. And we went bombed in Ukraine, and we went persecuted in 1993 when we came. So how much more so at this desperate time of war, and we call it war, we must consolidate and unite and use our resources and help. It's simple as that.
But that was the main reason that I called you in, because I know that there is a cause that you've thought about, and Sarah as well. We'll put up Sarah's number as well, because I know she wants to do something to help.
And Sarah already has an experience in helping people within our community, and obviously I believe I'll be very useful as a chef.
Mm.
And chef doesn't only mean that I know how to cook. It means I can help with the kitchen utensils and ingredients and supplies. And being as a rabbi and speaking the language, mm. I'll be able to make the right connection, understanding their mentality somewhat, and support them psychologically, mentally, and help them integrate in our community. So I'm just looking at myself, for me to sit and do nothing about it, it's not an option.
No.
Yeah.
Well, thank you so much, David. It's been really great to have you in the studio, back here. And we'll be back after the break with some music. My friends from Mullumbimby, Amir Pays, Avishai Banaton, and Shai Shriki are doing a show this week at Music Alive, which is at the White House. I'll be there filming it, and we'll talk to them about how they have survived the floods in northern New South Wales, which is another thing that's been big in the news.
For sure, we have to not forget we have our own issues to deal with. One doesn't exclude the other.
If it's not one thing, it's another.
One doesn't,
local,
yes,
and international. All right, we'll be back after the break with more Shtick. Thank you, David.
Thank you, Henry.